Hello everyone, hope you're doing well. This video is brought to you by tin cans and why you should be real careful using them in the kitchen. This is almost 2 weeks old by now, but back when I recorded footage it was fresh and new, so yeah. This keyboard is cursed. Now I know what you're thinking. Spaza, that looks like a perfectly normal Leopold. In fact, Leopolds are some of the best pre-built mechanical keyboards out there. So why is it cursed? Well, it's time for a history lesson. In the early years of OSU, the options for mechanical keyboards weren't quite as varied as they are today, especially in gaming. Due to the flashy RGB, hardcore gamer aesthetic and general popularity, almost every OSU top player ended up using a Razer keyboard at some point. Similarly to modern times, players have always had the desire to experiment around with different switches, to find out what they like best. At the time, however, hot swappable keyboards didn't really exist, since believe it or not, the first ever hot swappable keyboard was the Glorious Modular Mechanical Keyboard, GMMK in short, released in 2016. So how did players try out different switches then? Well, many of them just bought multiple keyboards, but a very popular trend was to take the whole keyboard apart and solder in different switches in sets of two. I don't know who exactly came up with the idea first, but the one who popularized it was definitely Wabo Wolf. He was using different pairs of switches in his numpad as to not impact the overall typing experience, as good as that could have been for a Razer keyboard from 2013. How does this correlate to my Leopold though? Well, back in 2019, when I first got this keyboard, I didn't really know what I was doing, so I asked Elysion to mod my keyboard to emulate the Wabo Wolf method, except I didn't do it on my numpad, I did it on the actual keys. Gateron Blacks for ZX, Gateron Clears for BN, Gateron Reds for M, comma. Needless to say, this makes the whole typing experience pretty weird, but not as weird as this older keyboard, featuring a total of 16 different switches. Absolutely insane. My goal today is to take these keyboards apart and uncurse them by replacing the switches with the intended ones. Let's get into it. I'm gonna start with the Leopold FC900R. This is a full-size keyboard featuring Cherry MX black switches. I'm gonna take the keycaps out and this normally takes a while, but check out this magic trick. Insane, right? This actually took me hours to edit, please like and subscribe. The Leopold has no screws on the front side, just one in the back, and beware that taking this out means voiding your warranty. Everything else is held together by plastic clips, meaning all I have to do is snap them out using a credit card or a little plastic tool like the one I have right here. After spending nearly 20 minutes trying to get this thing open, I realized there were two hidden screws behind the flip-up feet. That's great. You know what else is on the back of that keyboard though? A sticker from mechanicalkeyboards.com, the website where you can use code SPAZA at checkout to help support the channel. I'm not gonna do a full advert or anything, but just so you know, until December, if you use my code, you get the chance of winning a unique spacebar signed by me. More info in the description. After taking the screws out, I got the keyboard open, separated the top case, struggled a bit but eventually unplugged the connector, and at this point I was ready to start working on this wonderful green PCB. I got me some classic Cherry MX Blacks from Keygem, not a sponsor by the way, I fucking wish they were. I did get this nice solder sucker from Japan, the Engineer SS02, but you don't need anything too fancy to do keyboard stuff, generally speaking. Everything else including the soldering kit was pretty inexpensive and readily available on Amazon. Of course, before getting my hands on this Leopold I needed a bit of practice, so I asked Banggood if they could send me an RK61 with Otemu Browns, just so I could practice soldering live on Twitch. They were kind enough to send one my way, so big shout out to them, and they also provided some light rings that I'm gonna use for pretty much everything from now on. So I'll leave a link to those in the description down below. After getting the hang of it, desoldering the Leopold was actually pretty straightforward. Only two big solder joints per switch, super easy to take out, And look, I'm not trying to flex here, but I can solder pretty decently since, differently than desoldering, I've actually done it before. Plugging the keyboard back in, the keys work just fine, which means my Leopold has successfully been uncursed. I put all keycaps back on, and at this point I realized I forgot about the screws, which is not something you normally wanna do. Always make sure to screw your keyboard back together before you think about the keycaps. The other keyboard is a DEC Hassium Pro with blue LEDs. And I really wanna stress this, I'm gonna give you guys a very short summary here, but I have over 5 hours of footage, cause that's how long it took for me to uncurse this keyboard. Keycaps are out, and just look at this absolute mess. On the numpad we have Cherry MX clears, tactile greys, greens, and clicky whites. From row 1 to 3 we have Cherry MX blacks, browns, blues, and Razer orange. I don't even know. I wisened up from my Leopold experience, so I checked for every possible hidden screw, and this time the disassembly was super fast and easy, especially since the DEC Hassium was also held together by plastic clips. As I was getting ready to desolder, I could sense a strange smell coming from somewhere. At first, I thought it came from the outside, but as it turns out, I had left the protective plastic layer on the solder tip, causing it to melt. Needless to say, I turned everything off, waited for the tip to get cold again, and even made a tweet about it. The plastic had become rock solid, so I had to use a knife to get it off the tip. Everything seemed relatively clean, but I really didn't want to risk anything, cause God forbid I damaged the PCB or myself. So I ended up swapping the tip for another one. The larger solder joints were pretty easy since I got used to them, but I severely underestimated just how tedious it would be to desolder the LEDs. I had to resolder and desolder so many times it's not even funny. Now, I'm not gonna blame just the keyboard obviously, cause I'm a beginner when it comes to this, and I understand the more I do it, the better I get. But man, it was still absolutely miserable. At one point I even tried looking into how other people usually do this, cause maybe there were some things I was missing or some tools I could have used to make the job easier, and I guess Solder Wick could have been an option. But really, most people, and especially keyboard content creators, use the Hakko desoldering gun. I know this might be a misjudgment on my part, so please, tell me in the comments if this is true or not, but that desoldering gun actually looks so easy it's kind of unfair. The price and especially shipping to Italy are very likely gonna be a real pain, but it looks like such a good quality of life item, I might actually have to invest, especially because some of the projects I have in mind have to do with modding and improving pre-existing keyboards. After getting extremely frustrated, I did something you should never do. I changed my tip for a thinner one and literally just put the entire thing through the hole, as means to pull the LEDs out. It did work, but this is very risky since it could potentially damage the pad, impacting the functionality of the LEDs. After taking them all out, I took some Cherry MX red switches, soldered all of them back in with the LEDs, and I took a page out of Squashy's book, using tape to hold them in place. Once I plugged the keyboard back in, I was very happy to see that despite my rage and unconventional methods, all LEDs and keys seemed to work just fine, except for the 8th key on the numpad. At first I thought I somehow broke the LED, so I tried with another one, but after finding no success, I figured I had completely mangled the pad around the hole, making it essentially unusable. This is why you should be very patient and do things properly, especially at high temperatures. And by the way, the key worked, but hey, I guess no LED is the new aesthetic. Once again, if I were to describe all the little issues I encountered in the process of desoldering, this video would be way over an hour. And you may be asking, Spaza, why would you uncurse your keyboards? Well, first of all, I have the intention to sell this, and I really don't want anyone to go through all of this. I don't exactly know how I'm gonna sell them yet, but I think I'm gonna run some type of auction on my Discord server just to make sure someone who is actually in my community gets them instead of some random person on eBay. Other than that, I really just wanted to challenge myself, get my hands dirty, and practice. Regardless of all my mistakes and problems I had to face along the way, this was definitely a great learning experience for me, and I really look forward to doing this again. Though honestly, I might wanna invest in a desoldering gun ASAP. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure to leave a like, subscribe, leave a comment down below, and if you want, join my Discord too. Anyways, as you can tell, it's very late. It's in fact 2 a.m., so I'm gonna go to sleep. Good night, everyone.